Welcome, adventurers, to the heart of Oman's empty quarter, where the mysterious city of Iram beckons. Whether you know it as Ubar, Iram of the Pillars, or the Atlantis of the Sands, our quest today takes us on a captivating journey to unveil the secrets of this legendary city. Join us as we delve into the history of an ancient civilization, a realm of giants overseen by a king whose lineage traces back directly to Noah, a ruler known as Shaddad. Iram's story begins in the pages of the Quran, linked to the mighty tribe of Ad. Legend tells of a powerful civilization, builders of lofty structures, living in the land of Akaf, swept away by a violent wind. Some pre-Islamic poetry recounts the name, but the Quran was the earliest complete text to expound on the city of Iram and deliver a comprehensive account. Although the word Iram is used only once, the city is associated with a mighty tribe known as the Ad. The following verses outline the link between Ad and Iram. Have you not seen what your Lord did to the Ad of Iram with lofty pillars erected as signs in the desert, the like of whom were never created in the realm, and with Thamud, who carved rocks in the valley, and the mighty Pharaoh who terrorized the region and multiplied corruption? So your Lord poured a scourge of punishment over them. In certain Islamic traditions and folk narratives, the construction of the city of Iram is attributed to jinns, or genies, supernatural beings mentioned in Islamic theology and mythology. These stories often incorporate elements of magic and mysticism, portraying the city as a marvel built with otherworldly powers. These variations in the narrative highlight the diverse interpretations and cultural adaptations of the Iram story within the Islamic tradition. While the Quran provides an account of the people of Ad and their lofty structures, the details surrounding the construction of Iram have been subject to various interpretations over the centuries. In the 7th century, Ka'b al-Ahbar, a Jewish rabbi who converted to Islam, portrays an extravagant account of the people of Ad and the city of Iram. Muawiyah called Ka'b al-Ahbar and said, "O Abu Ishaq, have you received the information about a city in this world which is made of gold and silver? Its pillars are made of rubies and emeralds, and its palaces and windows are made of pearls. Its flowerbeds have trees and streams flow beneath them." Ka'b said, "Yes, such a city was built by Shaddad bin Ad. It is Iram Datul Imad." In the 16th century, the esteemed Ottoman literary figure Muhammad Abdul Baki, often hailed as the Sultan of Poets, portrayed Iram as nothing short of a paradise on earth. This representation marked a departure from factual accounts, highlighting a shift toward embellishment and grandiosity. While the oscillation between myth and reality persisted in Islamic literary circles throughout the medieval period, a pivotal moment occurred when a particular text firmly propelled the narrative into the realm of fantasy. This transformative text, initially translated into French in 1704 by Antoine Galland, is none other than Alf Layla wa Layala, more commonly recognized as 1001 Nights. This translation ignited an intense fascination with Iram, contributing significantly to its mythical allure. The 1001 Nights, also known as the Arabian Nights, stands as a treasury of countless Middle Eastern folktales that have captivated readers across generations. This collection, sought after for its magical, sensual, grotesque, and romantically embellished portrayals of a mystical land, has left an indelible mark on literature. Its enduring influence is evident as iconic tales like Aladdin's Wonderful Lamp and Ali Baba and the 40 Thieves, absent from the original Arabic version, found their place in the French rendition, ultimately becoming synonymous with Arabian culture, albeit diverging significantly from reality. Here, the most elaborate account of Iram reached European readers in Night 277 of 1001 Nights. It is related that Abdullah bin Abi Kilabah went forth in quest of a camel that had strayed from him. And as he was wandering in the deserts of Al-Yaman and the district of Saba, behold, he came to a great city girt by a vast castle around which were palaces and pavilions that rose high into middle air. He made for the place, thinking to find there folk of whom he might ask concerning his camel. But when he reached it, he found it desolate, without a living soul in it. "I alighted and, hobbling my dromedary and composing my mind, entered into the city. Now when I came to the castle, I found it had two vast gates, Never in the world was seen their like for size and height, inlaid with all manner jewels and jacinths, white and red, yellow and green. Beholding this, I marveled with great marvel and thought the case mighty wondrous. Then, entering the citadel in a flutter of fear and dazed with surprise and affright, I found it long and wide, about equaling Al-Madinah in point of size, and therein were lofty palaces laid out in pavilions, all built of gold and silver, and inlaid with many coloured jewels and jacinths and chrysolites and pearls. And the door leaves in the pavilions were like those of the castle for beauty, and their floors were strewn with great pearls and balls, no smaller than hazelnuts, of musk and ambergris and saffron. Now when I came within the heart of the city and saw therein no created beings of the sons of Adam, I was near swooning and dying for fear. Moreover, I looked down from the great roofs of the pavilion chambers and their balconies and saw rivers running under them. And in the main streets were fruit-laden trees and tall palms, and the manner of their building was one brick of gold and one of silver. So I said to myself, doubtless this is the paradise promised for the world to come. Then I loaded myself with the jewels of its gravel and the musk of its dust, as much as I could carry, and returned to my own country, where I told the folk what I had seen. In other ancient Islamic writings, additional texts shed light on the king of Iram. I am Shaddad the Great. I conquered 1,000 cities. 1,000 white elephants were collected for me. I lived for 1,000 years, and my kingdom covered both east and west. But when death came to me, nothing of all that I had gathered was of any avail. You who see me, take heed, for time is not to be trusted. The book recalls some reference to the construction of Iram. The quantities of these that reached the builders were more than could be described, counted, or quantified. 300 years were spent on the work, and when it was finished, the builders came to the king and told him that it was done. He then ordered them to build a strong fortress towering high over the city, around which there was to be 1,000 palaces, each supported on 1,000 pillars, every one the residence of a vizier. The builders left at once and spent 20 years on the work, after which they returned to Shaddad and told him that they had done what he wanted. He then ordered his 1,000 viziers, his principal officers, and the soldiers on whom he relied, together with others, to be ready to travel in order to move to Iram, city of the columns. The introduction of Iram through 1001 nights to a Western audience at a time of colonial expansion created a fervor. Explorers, writers, servicemen, and emerging archaeologists and anthropologists, relatively new fields of study at the time, turned attention towards finding this spectacular city to reveal its many thousands of secrets. During the 19th and 20th centuries, there was a notable surge in Western explorers eager to locate the legendary city of Iram. Among them were Bayard Taylor, Charles Montagu Doughty, and T.E. Lawrence, each driven by a fascination with the mysterious tales surrounding Iram. These explorers embarked on journeys, often perilous, into the deserts of the Arabian Peninsula, fueled by the desire to unveil the secrets of this mythical city. Bayard Taylor, an American poet and travel author, included a poem titled The Garden of Irem in his collection Poems of the Orient, 1854. Have you seen the Garden of Irem? No mortal knoweth the road thereto. The poem continues with Taylor's depiction of Iram's discovery. Till deep in the desert the spot I found, where the marvelous gates of Irem threw, their splendors over an unknown ground, mine were the pearl and ivory floors of mine the music of diamond doors. His verses echoed the allure and mystique of Iram, describing it as a hidden paradise awaiting discovery in the vast deserts. In 1888, Charles Montagu Doughty, an English explorer, documented his travels in Travels in Arabia. While exploring the region, he identified ancient ruins that he speculated could be remnants of Iram. His observations contributed to the ongoing quest to pinpoint the elusive city. T.E. Lawrence, renowned as Lawrence of Arabia for his role in the Arab revolt during World War I, expressed his conviction that the remains of an ancient Arab civilization, possibly Iram, could be found in the deserts. Despite not explicitly naming Iram, Lawrence's belief sparked further interest and speculation about the city's location. I am convinced that the remains of an ancient Arab civilization are to be found in that desert, I have been told by the Arabs that the ruined castles of the great king Ad, son of Kin-Ad, have been seen by wandering tribes in the region of Ubar. There is always some substance in these Arab tales. As archaeological excavations gained momentum in the 20th century, the spotlight once again turned toward the elusive city of Iram. The Middle East emerged as a hub for archaeological discoveries, with each new find surpassing the previous in astonishment. Despite significant breakthroughs in archaeological endeavors across Egypt, Mesopotamia, the Levant, and Central and Southern Arabia, Iram remained a tantalizing mystery. Critics of the Quran's account raised objections, contending that the pace of archaeological progress should have, by now, unveiled some form of the name Iram in the archaeological record. These criticisms, coupled with centuries of myth enshrouding Iram, led to accusations against the Quran suggesting that it contained parables and legends deemed untrue. It took nearly three decades for a groundbreaking discovery at an unrelated site to challenge these unfounded criticisms. Dr. Paolo Mattiai, leading the Italian archaeological mission from the University of Rome, directed excavations in a remote area of northern Syria to uncover the city of Ebla. By the mid-1970s, after 15 years of meticulous work, Dr. Mattiai successfully reconstructed the city, revealing houses, temples, walls, gates, and substantial structures. Ebla, a regional center dating back 4,500 years, stood as a formidable power, rivaling the empires of Egypt and Mesopotamia, and earning its place as the first recorded world power. In 1975, he and his team stumbled upon one of the most significant finds of the 20th century. Within the ruins of this ancient city, they unearthed over 15,000 cuneiform tablets, constituting one of the most substantial collections of ancient texts. These tablets provided valuable insights into the city's trade relationships with neighboring and regional cities, including Byblos, Damascus, Gaza, and others. Also mentioned was Iram. Yes, this was the first real evidence that the city was not only a legend. The Ebla tablets, numbering as many as 1,800 complete clay tablets, along with 4,700 fragments and numerous minor chips, were discovered in the palace archives of the ancient city of Ebla, located in present-day Syria. The tablets, found in situ on collapsed shelves, were preserved with contemporary clay tags for reference. Dating from approximately 2500 BC to the city's destruction around 2250 BC. The tablets cover diverse topics, offering insights into Syria and Canaan during the early Bronze Age. They include economic records, providing details about Ebla's trade relations and commercial activities with other Levantine cities. Iram was revealed as a legendary Iram, a city of towers and a major trade center. The presence of Iram in the Ebla tablets raises questions and sparks further interest in understanding the interconnectedness of ancient civilizations. Is it possible to locate Iram now? Scientists speculate that the city was lost during a cataclysm and lies buried beneath the sands of the desert Rub al Khali. Before we proceed, if you've enjoyed the information in this video, I would greatly appreciate it if you could give it a thumbs up. If you'd like to join the channel, hit the subscribe button. Your support means a lot and will help the channel grow. The Rub al Khali, also known as the Empty Quarter, is the largest continuous sand desert in the world, spanning parts of Saudi Arabia, Oman, the United Arab Emirates, and Yemen. Covering an area of approximately 650,000 square kilometers, 250,000 square miles, it presents a vast and challenging terrain. Locating the lost city of Iram within the Rub al Khali is an arduous task. The desert's immense size, coupled with its harsh conditions, poses significant challenges for exploration. The area is characterized by towering sand dunes, extreme temperatures, and a lack of visible landmarks, making it easy for structures to be buried and concealed over time. The shifting sands and the absence of prominent features add to the difficulty of pinpointing specific archaeological sites, including the mythical city of Iram. In the spring of 1946, English explorer Wilfred Thesiger visited the well at Shissa, observing the ruins of a primitive stone fort atop a rocky eminence believed to mark the location of the renowned well. Thesiger discovered shards at the site, suggesting possible early Islamic artifacts. The well served as the sole permanent watering place in the region, historically witnessing fierce encounters due to its significance to Bedouin raiders. In March 1948, a geological party from Petroleum Development, Oman and Dhofar, Litid, conducted a camel-borne survey of Dhofar province, approaching Shissa from the south along Wadi Gudun. The party spotted Ash Shissur as a distant white cliff, later revealing itself as the wall of a ruined fort perched above a cave-like quarry. Built from the same white rock as the cliff, the fort appeared as a unified structure. The geologists, lacking modern technology, described Shissur as a difficult water area and found the ruins unimpressive during their three-day stay. In 1953, oil magnate Wendell Phillips aimed to trace Thomas's path, but faced challenges due to heavy sands, rendering further motor transport travel impossible. In 1982, Nicholas Clapp, an American documentary maker, embarked on a unique quest to uncover the mysteries of Ubar, the legendary lost city. Rather than searching amidst the sands of the Rub al Khali, Clapp delved into historical map, specifically Ptolemy's 2nd century map of Arabia, which marked a city called Omanum Emporium. Translated as Omani Market in Latin, this city was believed to be a crucial trading stop on the incense caravan route from Arabia to Jerusalem, Damascus, and Rome. Taking an audacious approach, Clapp proposed using ground penetration radar on the space shuttle to detect ancient camel tracks invisible to the human eye. NASA agreed, and the focus shifted to an oasis site called Shissur. While not a new discovery, Shissur had been previously explored by American oil prospectors in the 1950s, yielding no results. Clapp, joined by Sir Ranulf Fiennes in 1990, uncovered more than expected at Shissur. Beneath the fort ruins, evidence of extensive structures, including walls and towers, emerged. Pottery fragments dating back at least 2,000 years authenticated the site. Clapp and his team discovered a large octagonal fortress dating back around 2,000 years beneath the deteriorating fort. They described a massive sinkhole around the well, with a collapsed limestone table beneath the main gate. This finding led some to identify it as the legendary city of Ubar, also known as Iram, or at least a city in the Ubar region, once a crucial trading post on the incense route from Dhofar to the Mediterranean region. Guided by Juris Zarins, the team initiated excavation efforts, revealing the walls and towers of a fortress dating back over 2,000 years within a few weeks. Clapp proposed that the evidence presented a convincing match for the mythical lost city of Ubar. He theorized that the city's demise occurred between AD 300 and 500, attributed to an earthquake that led to the collapse of the limestone table. Zarins himself concluded that Shissur did not represent a city called Ubar. In a 1996 interview on the subject of Ubar, he said, "There's a lot of confusion about that word. If you look at the classical texts and the Arab historical sources, Ubar refers to a region and a group of people, not to a specific town. People always overlook that. It's very clear on Ptolemy's 2nd century map of the area. It says in big letters, Iobarite. And in his text that accompanied the maps, he's very clear about that. It was only the late medieval version of 1001 Nights in the 14th or 15th century that romanticized Ubar and turned it into a city rather than a region or a people." In 2004, Dr. Abdullah Al-Said, a neurologist and founder of the Desert Team, a group of amateur archaeologists in Saudi Arabia, explored the bleak lava field known as Harat Kaibar. He saw walls of stones stacked about 3 feet high, but did not grasp their unique design at that time. Then in 2008, he revisited the same spot from his desktop computer. "When I saw the updated images of Harat Kaibar from Google Earth, I was literally stunned and could not sleep that night." He spoke to his colleagues and they set out to investigate the most striking structure they saw in person. The question we always discuss while investigating them is, why here? "Why in this stony, frightful, rugged land?" he said. He snapped several photos and sent them along with Google images to archaeologists like Dr. Kennedy for feedback. "Absolute bafflement." That's what Dr. Kennedy said he felt when he first saw the satellite images. Suddenly, he was confronted with structures quite different from anything he had ever seen before. He called them gates because when looked at horizontally, they resemble a simple fence with two thick upright posts on the sides, connected by one or more long bars. They don't look like funerary for disposing of dead bodies. They don't look like structures where people lived, and they don't look like animal traps, he said. I don't know what they are. He termed them gates and discovered numerous of these geoglyphs, dating back over 7,000 years, establishing them as among the oldest geoglyphs on Earth. In the Al Hayt region in Saudi Arabia near Medina, keyhole and pendant shapes vary in size from a few meters to dozens of meters, and they are often found arranged along avenues. These structures are likely burial sites dating as far back as 7,000 BC, similar to late Neolithic and early Bronze Age structures found in Jordan. If so, then who is buried there? In the heart of the Rub al Khali desert, a realm of swirling sands and endless dunes, a series of remarkable discoveries has unveiled the secrets of an ancient civilization that thrived thousands of years ago. This is no mere legend. It is a reality that echoed through the corridors of time. The city, with its legendary thousands of pillars mentioned in the Quran and the captivating tales of 1001 nights, emerges as more than just a beautiful fable. The revelations and unearthed knowledge affirm a mysterious aura surrounding the people of Ad. Referred to as an old one, sometimes characterized as jinn in the Quran, but never as mere mortals, they were colossal, formidable beings. Consider the monumental walls of Iram and the extensive stone geoglyphs stretching across kilometers. Who, if not these formidable beings, could have fashioned such grandeur? Strikingly absent from the Christian and Jewish Bible, the people of Ad find a semblance in the Nephilim. The book of Genesis narrates a tale of the sons of God intermingling with the daughters of men, birthing children who were half gods, giants. Could the Nephilim then be the enigmatic people of Ad? This enigma deepens as the book of Genesis designates the Nephilim as the old ones. In the Quran, the jinn share an intriguing connection with humans, and they are also known as an old ones. Adding another layer of mystery, the Arabic term column in Iram of the columns reveals an alternative meaning. Old, consequently, Iram of the columns unfolds as Iram of the old ones, and its inhabitants could well have been the jinn. According to the lore of local tribes, the stone structures shaped like keys were erected by these old ones, known as jinn in Islam and Nephilim in the Bible. As we embark on this journey of exploration, delving into the pages of another ancient manuscript, the Book of Enoch, we anticipate unraveling more layers of this captivating mystery. Join us in the pursuit of understanding the secrets concealed within the sands of time.